saying that, taken as a whole, the testimonies did not point to his guilt. This would be NIST-style forensic science. NIST continued this approach in its World Trade Center report. There had been several credible reports of explosions. A reporter for the New York Daily News said, "There was a rumble. The building's top row of windows popped out. Then all the windows on the 39th floor popped out. Then the 38th floor. Pop, pop, pop. All you heard until the building sunk into a rising cloud of gray." New York PD officer Craig Bartmer said, "I was real close to Building 7 when it came down. All of a sudden, I looked up, and the thing started peeling in on itself. I started running, and the whole time you're hearing boom, 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 boom." Besides ignoring these and other reports of explosions made by people outside Building 7, NIST distorted the testimony of two highly credible men who were inside, Michael Hess, who was New York City's Corporation Counsel, and Barry Jennings, the Deputy Director of the Emergency Services Department of the New York City Housing Authority. Immediately after the North Tower was struck that morning, both men followed the instruction that, whenever there was an emergency, they were to meet Mayor Giuliani at his emergency management center on the 23rd floor of Building 7. The North Tower was struck at 8:46, so they arrived about 9 o'clock. They found, however, that everyone had already left. Calling to find out what they should do, they were told to get out of the building quickly. So, finding that the elevator would not work, evidently because the attack on the South Tower had occurred and that knocked out the electricity for the whole system, they started running down the stairs. But when they got to the 6th floor, Jennings reported, there was an enormous explosion that knocked the landing out from under them, and he was able just barely to hold on and then pull himself up and then get back up to the 8th floor, where they broke a window and signaled for help. Firemen came to rescue them, Jennings said, but then ran away. Coming back after a while, the firemen again started to rescue them, but they ran away again. They had to run away the first time, Jennings explained, because of the collapse of the South Tower, which had occurred at 9:59. They were on the back of the building, so they couldn't see this, but they realized later that this is what was going on. And they ran away the second time because the North Tower collapse, which occurred at 10:28. On that basis, Jennings told Dylan Avery in an interview in 2007, he knew that when the big explosion occurred, both buildings were still standing, meaning both towers. Finally, when the firemen returned after the second tower collapsed, Hess and Jennings were interviewed. This must have been sometime between 11 o'clock and 11:30, because at 11:57, Hess gave an on-the-street interview several blocks away. Jennings also gave an on-the-street interview. Both men reported that they had been trapped for some time. Hess specified about an hour and a half. This story was obviously very threatening to NIST. It was going to claim that when Building 7 came down at 5:21 that afternoon, it did so solely because of fires. There were no explosions to help things along. But here were two city officials reporting that a big explosion had gone off pretty early in the morning, evidently before 9:30. In his interview for Dylan Avery, moreover, Jennings said that the big explosion that trapped them was simply the first of many. He also said that when the firefighter took them down to the lobby, he saw that it had been totally destroyed and that they were stepping over people. Contrary to the official story, according to which no one was killed in Building 7. Well, what could NIST do? It simply ignored Jennings' report about the lobby, and with regard to the time that Jennings and Hess had been trapped, they followed the line that had been taken by Rudy Giuliani in a book written in 2002, according to which the event that Hess and Jennings took to be an explosion within World Trade Center 7 was simply the impact of debris from the collapse of the North Tower. But that collapse did not occur until 10:28, whereas the event as described by Hess and Jennings had occurred at least an hour earlier. Also, Jennings said that the South Tower as well as the North Tower was still standing when the event he called an explosion occurred, and that is surely what he told NIST when it interviewed him as well as Hess in the spring of 2004. Another problem was that Hess had said that they had been trapped for about an hour and a half. If the event that trapped them did not happen until almost 10:30, as NIST claims, then they would not have been rescued until before noon. And sure enough, in an interim report on World Trade Center 7 put out by NIST in 2004, it claimed that Hess and Jennings had been rescued at 12:10 to 12:15 p.m. But that is clearly false, given the fact that Hess was being interviewed several blocks away before noon. NIST would, of course, deny that it had distorted Jennings' testimony. But when we sent a Freedom of Information Act request to NIST to obtain a copy of the Hess and Jennings interview, it declined on the basis of a provision that allows for an exemption from FOIA requests if the information is not directly related to the building failure. NIST is thereby suggesting that the report of a massive explosion within a building could have had nothing to do with that building's collapse. Using such an obviously phony reason seemed to be NIST's way of saying, there's no way on God's good earth that you're going to see these interviews. In any case, NIST's attempt to neutralize the testimony of Barry Jennings was aided by the BBC, which interviewed Jennings and then obviously changed the timeline so that the narrator with her reassuring voice could say, at 10:28, the North Tower collapses. This time, Tower 7 takes a direct hit from the collapsing building. Early evidence of explosives were just debris from a falling skyscraper. Last week, Mike Rudin, who produced this BBC program, called me about interviewing me for my little book, Osama bin Laden, Dead or Alive. I told him that I had a book coming out shortly about World Trade Center 7 that, after seeing it, he probably wouldn't want to interview me. When he asked why, I said because I pointed out that he had obviously distorted the timeline of Jennings' account. When he denied this, I said, okay, show me the uncut, unedited interview. And if it turned out that Rudin had been right, that he hadn't falsified Jennings' account, I would have told the world. For some reason, however, Mike Rudin declined. This BBC program had appeared in July of 2008. The first version of NIST's final report, its draft for public comment, was to be released at a press conference on August 21st, at which time Sunder would announce that the mystery of the collapse had been solved. 2 days prior to that, Barry Jennings reportedly died, and died very mysteriously. No one has been willing to provide any information as to how or why this 53-year-old man suddenly died. Dylan Avery, trying to find out something, hired a private investigator, reputed to be one of the best in the state of New York, to find out what she could. He used his credit card to pay her a considerable fee. Within 24 hours, however, Dylan Avery received a message from her saying, due to some of the information I have uncovered, I have determined that this is a job for the police. I have refunded your credit card. Please do not contact me again about this individual. This is not the response one would expect, Avery observed, if she had merely found that Jennings had passed away innocently in a hospital. The dedication page on my book, The Mysterious Collapse of World Trade Center 7, says, to the memory of Barry Jennings, whose truth-telling may have cost him his life. Be that as it may, his death was very convenient for NIST, which did not need to fear that Jennings might hold his own press conference to say that NIST had lied about his testimony. It was also convenient for the BBC, which could now put out a second version of its program on World Trade Center 7, this time including Michael Hess. In the first version, the BBC had pretended that Jennings had been in the building all by himself. Even though Jennings would say, "We did this, and then we did that," the BBC would speak only of Jennings, never mentioning the fact that Hess was with him. But in the new version, which was aired at the end of October 2008, Hess was the star. While admitting that back on 9/11, he had assumed that there had been an explosion in the basement, he said, "I know now this was caused."